We have the IMO World Maritime Day. This year the theme was about effective implementation. And the point is, are we doing enough? Is the implementation of regulations effective in industry? Should we need, let's say, more regulation? Is it enough? Are we doing enough? I will let you answer these questions. I have my own views. I'm one of those who believe that the industry is underperforming. I'm one of those who believe that besides all the, you know, good stuff you hear, the real-time the real-life situation is worse than what you think. I have an inside view of hundreds of companies, not only in Greece, also outside Greece. I'm on one of those who believe that what will happen to the house next to you, it will come to your door. Sooner or later, it will come to your door. So this year, IMO dedicated the World Maritime Day, that was on the 25th of September, a few days ago, on effective implementation. And IMO has a number of initiatives to support this effective implementation of IMO conventions for the flag states and via the port state control. So I will, as I said, I will let you draw your own conclusions. It's one of the debatable issues, if we're doing enough and if the implementation of the regulations is effective. My whole, let's say, presentation will stick in two slides. This is the first one. This is a trend line. You see the red trend line. This is data from IHS Fairplay. It's not my data. This is published by DNVGL Maritime Impact a few months ago. And you see that the accident ratio is growing over time. The trend line goes up. This means that we have an underperforming industry. This is the data supporting what I said earlier on. Okay, now, and one of the things I was earlier in September in London in the ICS conference, and I also attended two other conferences in Germany and London, and unfortunately many people feel that we do a lot of things and we are a super duper, let's say, industry, unbeatable by any other, let's say, safety intensive industry. I would like to, this is the second slide, I would like to point out, this is a slide, this is one of the things you don't see every day, but these are available data to you. We have 5 key accidents over the last 5 years, starting with Deepwater Horizon, that happened back in April 2010. Then we go with Rina, that happened in October 2011, it was the 5th of October, it was the day that we held the SAFETY4SEA Athens. Rina happened, let's say, 3 years ago. Costa Concordia, that happened in 2012. Mall Comfort, 2013. Yesterday, Glass & K released the official report. You can read the report. You can, of course, draw your own conclusions. There's also a Lloyd's report, and I think it will be a DNV report on the Mall Comfort. You can, let's say, read out as many reports as you wish. The conclusion is the same. How on earth you take a new container ship, 5 years old, built by Mitsubishi Heavy Industries, one of the best shipyards in the world, classed by Class NK, one of the best classification societies in the world, operated by Mitsui OSK Lines, one of the best operators in the world, breaking in two, in the middle of nowhere, in the Indian Ocean. How on earth can something like this happen? You can draw your own conclusions. And of course, we have seawall. Now, we have some, let's say, unfortunate conclusions we can draw out of these 5, let's say, key profile, high profile accidents. The first one is, despite what you think, this is a repeated trend with a fixed frequency, once every year. Once every year. Okay, it's not uncommon, it's common, it's happening once every year. The second, behind the besides, let's say, the Seawall and the Rina, 20 years old, all other, let's say, vessels, or even Deepwater Horizon was a mobile offshore drilling unit, classed by ABS, certified with ISM, all of these are, let's say, new constructions. We are talking about various flags and class, not necessarily any sort of problem behind it, and, of course, we're talking about top classification societies and top flag states, not something like Georgia or Mongolia flag state or something like that. Then we have no tanker in these accidents. We haven't seen any tanker incident for a long period of time, which is interesting. Then we have severe consequences as a common outcome. In the case of Deepwater Horizon, the costs for BP are, I think, are in excess of, in the range, let's say, $50 to $80 billion for BP, who are, let's say, the company behind it. For Rina, the company who operated Rina, today they operate no ships. I would say it's not existing. However, CL Ship Management, they operate no ships today. Okay, Costamare, of course, still exists, the parent company of all this setup. The Costa Concordia case has cost billion in the industry so far, you know that. No problem with the Mall Comfort. However, the company of Sewol has shut down operations. So you may have severe consequences out of this one. Then all of these accidents have happened to close proximity of public eye, meaning that the mass media, the media had access to photographs, videos, etc., which is very interesting. If you have the public eye in close proximity, you will have problems, believe it or not. In all these cases, we have the common feature of very slow progress on the investigation. Even in the case of Costa Concordia, for example, even Kotsimizu-san, the Secretary General of IMO, has repeatedly asked for such an investigation. The investigation produced by the Italian authorities is considered, let's say, substandard by many industry insiders. We will never find out what happened in the case of Costa Concordia for a number of reasons. What really happened? What most of the people discuss about in the Costa Concordia is that the captain left the ship and the captain, blah, blah, blah. Nothing about what really happened over there. And despite the fact that we have similar accidents like Costa Concordia, we had one in Greece in April 2007. It was called Sea Diamond. It was let's say, identical incident. So we have a very slow progress on the investigation. However, the market is always very rapid, very prompt response. For example, in the Costa Concordia again, Cruise Line Industry Association agreed in a number of measures within, I think, 1 month or 45 days after the incident. So this is very fast. The same applies with Mall Comfort. The same applies with Sewol. Korean authorities shut down company operation within, I think, 20 days. They had everyone into jail within, I think, 10 or 20 days in South Korea. And you see the case of Deepwater Horizon, such cases actually end up in a conclusion normally in 20 or 30 years. If you go in the US, the US authorities have been very fast on, let's say, assigning responsibility and trying to minimize any such, let's say, future incident. The last one, which is a, let's say, takeaway of this forum, we need a new unit to measure oil pollution. As you see here, the death toll, the oil pollution, and the Exxon Valdez equivalent. So I suggest we should measure oil pollution equivalent in Exxon Valdez, let's say. If you go in any industry, if you go into the astrophysics industry, NASA is not, let's say, counting distance by meters or kilometers. They use parsec. Parsec is 3.2 light years. So it's a very long distance. It's 19 trillion kilometers. The distance of every star you see here, it's 500 parsec. So you do the maths, trillions, or I don't know the number, zillion of kilometers from here. If you go into Formula One, they don't measure distance in meters. They measure distance in seconds, because it's very, you know, relative what the distance of between cars. So we need a new unit to measure oil pollution. I think that this unit should be Exxon Valdez. If you go to Deepwater Horizon, that is 10 times the Exxon Valdez. If you go to Rina, which is amazing, many people think that Rina is more or less produced a pollution equivalent to one Exxon Valdez. It's only 0.5% of Exxon Valdez. So this is a takeaway. We need a new unit to measure oil pollution. This is where we stand as an industry. And if you go back into what I said earlier on, the trend goes up. We have to be worried. We have to be alerted. It doesn't matter what, let's say, the papers or the figures say. This is a real-life situation. What is happening next door, it will come to your door, rather sooner or later. So, and these are, let's say, the 10 conclusions I draw up. And I'm just asking you, and those who are interested in the scholarship, to visit the ALBA booth. That's it for me, and thank you very much.